We're running a little bit behind, but that's okay. We usually catch up by the end of the day. If everybody could kind of grab your seats and we'll get started. Our first session this morning is reestablishing aquatic vegetation. First and foremost, did you all have fun last night? Good. Glad you enjoyed, as my dad would have said. Our first session this morning is reestablishing aquatic vegetation, and our first speaker will be Rick Ott from Texas Parks and Wildlife. Rick will be talking about establishing aquatic plants in reservoirs, why and how.
Thank you, Craig. For the last 20 years, the Inland Fisheries Branch of Texas Parks and Wildlife Department has been developing and refining the techniques necessary to establish aquatic vegetation communities and reservoirs. Our goal in this whole plan was to make every mistake and endure every failure possible. And I think we're almost there. But what I'd like to do today is to present y'all some of the techniques that have worked for us, at least in our Texas area. And there may be some things that you can apply in your local situations as well. To get just a little bit of background information, some of the ecological impacts of aquatic vegetation. Some of the major ecological processes that aquatic vegetation influences are things like light transmission, water temperature flow and chemistry, substrate changes, oxygen production and consumption, carbon flux, both inorganic and organic carbon flux, and nutrient flow and decomposition. Now, the big question is, why do we as fisheries managers feel that it's important to establish aquatic plants? And anybody that has ever talked to bass anglers anywhere in the Southeast have heard the term grass equals bass. We know that those aquatic macrophytes are definitely important to a lot of our centrarchid populations. But typically, in reservoir situations, we'll see one of three scenarios that influence our decision to try to establish aquatic vegetation. The first is where there just is none. It's a relatively new system. You may have had enough fluctuation in the past that you simply don't have any aquatic vegetation at all. And we're trying to provide sustainable habitat for the fish. We're trying to provide, you know, improved water quality, reduced erosion, and things like that. The second scenario is where we may have some aquatic vegetation, but the diversity of that community is relatively low. And we're trying to increase the diversity of that plant community in some way. The third situation, and it's most common in my area in East Texas, is where the only aquatic vegetation that we have is one of the exotic nuisance species, something that's not staying in good balance with the rest of the ecosystem. In these situations, what we're trying to do is establish some of these native vegetations that can fill the niche left by the control of one of these exotic species. Of all the situations we've got, that has proven to be the biggest challenge that we've had. So why is it so tough to establish aquatic vegetation in reservoirs? Well, one of the things that you've got to consider is that aquatic habitats are really a harsh place for plants anyway. Sunlight is certainly limited by the water itself. The gases necessary for photosynthesis are much more rare in an aquatic system than they are in a terrestrial system. In the atmosphere, we measure carbon dioxide in percent, parts per hundred. In an aquatic ecosystem, we measure carbon dioxide in parts per million. So it's 10,000 times more rare in an aquatic ecosystem than it is in a terrestrial ecosystem. The other major problem that we've identified is that reservoirs are relatively young systems. They're very young ecologically. Most of the reservoirs, at least in Texas, are less than 60 years old. So you simply haven't had the time necessary for a lot of the propagules to arrive at that body of water through natural mechanisms. The other issue that we have is that compared to natural lakes, reservoirs fluctuate much more rapidly. You may have annual fluctuations. I heard some of the presentations yesterday where they were talking 25 to 40 feet. And I feel for you. I really do. We don't have those issues, at least where I am. But even in 4 to 6 foot fluctuation, that offers challenges in making sure that you can develop these stands of aquatic plants that can stay wet long enough to go through their growth cycle. We have turbidity issues. We have both clay turbidity and phytoplankton turbidity that additionally limit the amount of sunlight that can get to the bottom. And then we have herbivory or biotic disturbances. And those biotic disturbances are things that we'll talk about here later. So one of the main things that we had to find was ways to overcome these obstacles. And in terms of the lack of propagules, we found that we can introduce seeds, or we can introduce cuttings, or we can introduce potted propagules. But if you didn't know that going into this kind of a program, you wouldn't realize how important that was. We found some ways to manage water level fluctuations through the use of mature transplants and the actual depth that we're planting, time of year. As far as turbidity and light limitation, again, we use mature transplants. And I'm going to explain why we do what we do here in a little bit. As far as herbivory and biotic disturbances, we talk about using protective exclosures. You oftentimes hear the term stuck between a rock and a hard place. When you're trying to establish aquatic vegetation, you're sometimes stuck between a dark and a dry place. And that's kind of what we're showing over here on the left side of the screen. So we've got a number of considerations that we've got to go through in determining when, where, and how we're going to establish these aquatic plant communities. We want to look at the approach that we're going to take, species selection, propagule acquisition. You can't necessarily just go down to Lowe's or Home Depot and buy these things. Site selection, planting techniques, herbivory management, and then finally monitoring and management of these areas. The approach that we've taken has been a founder colony approach. You start with a good, well-rooted propagule, something that's really root-bound in a pot and that's grown to a tall height, and we'll explain why this is important in a minute. You establish that in an exclosure of some kind. Initially, we tried using plastic mesh exclosures and found that beavers and other aquatic animals will chew through those things rather rapidly. But you establish them with just a few pots in that exclosure of whatever that species is that you're trying to grow. That species grows to fill the exclosure and eventually will outgrow the exclosure and colonize satellite colonies from there. It all sounds really simple, but there's a lot of things that go into the selection of these areas. What we're trying to establish is a truly diverse native plant community. We're not trying to establish just one species. We're trying to establish multiple species and multiple growth forms. And again, in terms of the stability of that plant community and the ability to endure different environmental conditions that are going to happen and things that you can't predict, the more diversity that you have, particularly in growth form, the better off you are. We're after something with a fairly open architecture. We still want to maintain the ability of sunlight to make it to the bottom. That's going to influence the germination of the plants that we're using, as well as some of the other ecosystem functions. So in most cases, we try to use a combination of submerged species, emergent species, and floating leaf species. Just to give you an idea of what these different species are all about, an emergent species is one where a lot of the plant biomass grows above the water column. Obviously, for these species, that carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is much more available than it is for the submerged species. Floating leaf species is one where the major photosynthetic material, the leaves, are at the surface or slightly above the surface. And a submerged species is one that undergoes its entire life cycle submerged, or in some cases, just sort of matted up and having part of that biomass floating on the surface. These emergent species work best for us really from the shoreline out to about 2 feet in depth. They grow anchored to the sediment. They've got emergent leaves and seeds, provide structure and habitat for fish and invertebrates. A lot of these species provide excellent food for waterfowl as well. So we get some benefit not just to the fish community, but to some of the other aquatic organisms that live there. Many of these species have got the ability to deter invasion by non-native species. And we try to capitalize on that through a process that we call preemption. Finally, they can improve water quality just by stabilizing the shoreline and reducing erosion. Some of the species that we've worked with, and in Texas, we've got around 20 or 21 different species that we found that work really well for us with the environmental conditions that we've got statewide. And for those of you that aren't really familiar with Texas, Texas has got fairly high rainfall in the eastern part of the state. Some of our eastern counties will average 48 to 50 inches of rainfall a year. By the time we get out to El Paso, we've only got 10 inches of rainfall a year. So we go from a very moist and humid environment in East Texas to very arid conditions out west. And when we are developing these techniques and developing the species that we typically use, we wanted plants that would work across that entire range. So when we did our initial research, we were looking at reservoirs that were way, way different environmental conditions in terms of not just fluctuation, but annual rainfall, the amount of sunlight that we could get to the bottom, and things like that. So the species that I'm going to be talking about today are the ones that have worked best for us throughout that entire range of conditions. But things like bull tongue, arrowhead, tall burrhead, creeping burrhead, some of the spike rushes, square stem spike rush, slender spike rush, water hyssop, maiden cane, pickerel weed, water willow. Tom is going to talk about water willow later on. I think water willow may be Tom's very favorite plant of all time. He may call me on that later on, but soft stem bulrush, flat stem spike rush. Also some of the floating leaf species. Now again, compared to a terrestrial community, the total number of species that we can select from that grow in truly aquatic environments are much reduced over what they'd be in terrestrial communities. And again, it's got to do with the fact that it's difficult for plants to grow in a truly aquatic community. The floating leaf species typically grow in water 1 to 6 feet deep. They grow anchored to the substrate with the emergent leaves at the surface or above the surface. Again, providing structure and food for invertebrates and other wildlife. Food directly for wildlife, the seeds and stems and things like that. Again, can deter invasive species and can improve water quality and control erosion. Some of the species that we've had really good luck with are the white water lily, spatterdock, American lotus, and in our really acid waters in East Texas, water shield is another species that we've had some luck with. I don't know if you've ever had any contact with water shield. It's kind of a neat little lily with this real gelatinous stem. It's got this really slimy gelatinous cover on the stem down under the surface. So we refer to that as snot stem lily. But the submerged species can tolerate water depths, you know, much in excess of what we can with the emergent species. We've seen a lot of these that can grow in water out to about 10 feet deep, grow anchored to the sediment, and again, have got a lot of the same ecological benefits that some of the emergent and other species do. In terms of our fish communities, though, we've got more direct benefit to the fish communities through these submerged species just because so much of the plant biomass is under the surface where those fish exist. Some of the species that we've had the most luck with are some of the pondweeds, the American pondweed, the Illinois pondweed, sago pondweed, wild celery. If I had to define my favorite aquatic plant, wild celery is by far my favorite. Water stargrass, coontail, southern naiad, muskgrass. So, how do you go about, if you've got a project like this that you're wanting to establish, where do you go to get these propagules? In a lot of cases, you don't have these species already on site. They may not be even in that general area. reservoirs are constructed in areas where you didn't have a lot of standing water to begin with. So it's almost like island biogeography when you're trying to establish these plants in a new system. They've got to be transported from somewhere else. And we can either wait the long time necessary for them to be transported through natural mechanisms, or we can accelerate succession ourselves. But in order to do that, we've got to have a source of propagules. There are some limited commercial sources. We're just now beginning to see some entities that are raising some of these aquatic plants. It's fairly easy to find some of the exotic species. You can go into aquarium shops and you can find species that are prevalent across the rest of the world, but if you're trying to find the species that are native to your area, and particularly the ecotypes that are native to your local area, it may be much more difficult to find them. So early on, we found that it was necessary to produce these things ourselves. You want to avoid using bare root transplants, particularly from other systems. There's so much chance of contamination, whether it's with zebra mussels or with other exotic species that you've got in a different body of water. We try to avoid doing that whenever we can. And there's a few exceptions that we'll talk about. Some of the water willow colonies that we found can do quite well in bare root. But one of the ways to have a reliable source of these propagules is to grow your own. Upfront costs are fairly reasonable, doesn't require a whole lot of time, and you can produce these things relatively cheaply in a small area. So initially, when we got into this whole thing, we were getting all of our aquatic plants from the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. They've got a research lab in Lewisville, Texas. Our costs at that time, because they were a research facility and not a production facility, it was about $12.50 for a 4-inch pot of plants. And you can see where, to agencies that don't have a whole lot of money, it would be just not cost effective to go out and buy enough plants to get established in a good size system. So we decided that we would use the same techniques that they were using. We'd build facilities to do these things ourselves. The system that we found that works the best for us is a fairly simple raceway system. These are 4 by 16 foot. They're made of wood. We use just a regular pond liner inside these systems. The 4-foot width is nice because you can reach all the way across that thing, and you can reach pots that are in the middle of that raceway without having to climb in, climb out. The 2-foot height gives us a lot of variability. We can vary the water level in that raceway from just several inches deep for the pots of some of our emergent species, or we can raise it up to that full 2-foot level for our submerged species. The next thing that you've got to do is you've got to select the sites on that reservoir where you're going to establish these species. And again, there's a number of ecological functions that you want to take into consideration. Obviously, the substrate is something that's very, very important. If it's a hard clay pan or a rocky substrate, it's going to be very difficult, first of all, to get these pots in the ground, but it's also going to be difficult for the roots of these plants and the rhizomes to colonize outside of the areas that you're protected. We've developed a very, very sophisticated test that allows us to establish if we've got the right substrate consistency. That is that you take your index finger and you shove it down into the substrate up to the knuckle. If it doesn't hurt, it's soft enough for those plants to grow. Now, while you're out there doing that, if you're sinking and that mud has come up above your knees and you're in chance of drowning, that's not a good location either. It's going to be difficult to get your cages built out there, and that substrate is not consolidated enough that these plants aren't going to sink down into that substrate. You want a fairly gentle gradient, again, because you're trying to establish some kind of a protective exposure first, and you want to be able to build that in a fairly level area. Avoid residences. If you've got a body of water where you've got homes all the way around that body of water, there's a couple of things going on. First of all, that home has probably got a bulkhead or a beachfront wall to reduce erosion, and that's a really high energy area where you know, you're going to have a lot of wave action, a lot of soil movement of one kind or another, and it's going to be really difficult to get the plants established. The other issue is if you start building these protective cages and putting plants out in front of these residences, they're not going to be there when you come back to look at them a week later. And nobody's going to be able to tell you where they went. So just say no. In terms of the site selection, again, you've got different depths that you're going to select for these different species type. The emergent species do best in water up to about 2 feet deep. Floating leaf species between 1 and 3 feet deep, and the submerged species in water between 1 and 4 feet deep. Now that's for the initial establishment. They can colonize beyond these levels after they are established and you've got good photosynthetic material that's grown tall enough to get to the light source. But this is a good depth to consider actually getting these things established. The other thing about site selection is water level fluctuation. And this is just a hydrograph of Lake Waxahachie. We had a project that we were going to do out there. We had done our homework. We looked at the hydrograph. We calculated what our average annual fluctuation was. And we felt very confident that we could go out in July at just the right level. We could conduct our plantings at that time and that those plants would be at exactly the water level that we wanted them to be in when the water level came back up. Well, unfortunately, the water level didn't come back up. It cratered. It went way down. Most of our plants, most of our cages were exposed at that point to the elements. They dried out. People drove up to our enclosures. They stole the mesh. They used them to make chicken coops. And then to add insult to injury, we had a flood the following spring, and anything that we could possibly have kept in the water column was under 8 or 10 feet of highly turbid water for some time. So, like I say, when we talk about having tried to make all the mistakes you could possibly make, this was a pretty good failure. And unfortunately, we had developed a really good stand of the wild celery that we wanted to get out there, and it was growing beautifully right up to the point that the water level dropped completely out from under it. So the techniques that we use, there are some little subtle things that you've got to consider when you're actually establishing these plant communities. Transportation of the plants from one place to another can be a little bit more difficult than you might consider. You don't want to transport them in the back of an open truck. They're going to desiccate very rapidly, and particularly out here in the arid states, you could lose your whole colony of plants just in an hour's trip from where you've raised those plants until the reservoir you want to put them in. So you use some kind of a tote with a lid that you can, usually in the back of a closed pickup truck works really well. Avoid excessive heat. Try to get your moving done under, in the evening or have the plants out there to the lake early in the morning. In terms of the actual introduction of those propagules to the substrate and the reservoir you're using, it's just like bedding plants. It's just like any kind of garden vegetable you'd use. Start with a potted plant, you remove the pot from the root ball, dig a hole a little bit larger than the root ball, place the root ball in the hole with the substrate, level it back up. What we tell our volunteers is brown side down, green side up. Again, remove the pot, dig a hole. Once you've dug your hole, you've got those things in the water, place your exclosure around that pot. So this is the first that we've really talked about exclosures. What's all this business about exclosures? Why do you have to, if you're going to raise these things in a system where they're going to be exposed to herbivores anyway, why do you have to establish them in an exclosure initially? Well, any plant that you initially move is going to go through a little bit of what's called transplant stress. A lot of their energy goes into growing root mass instead of growing that sprout initially. And you want to protect those things and make sure that you've got enough of that green photosynthetic material left after the herbivores have done with it, that you've got something that's going to establish. And these herbivores come in a number of forms. We've got fish. If you've got common carp or grass carp, they're going to cause problems. Turtles love aquatic plants. And the one that they love the absolute best is wild celery. It is turtle candy. They just can't get enough of that stuff. Part of the reason that it's so appealing to herbivores is it doesn't have that hard cell wall with all the cellulose in it that terrestrial plants do. They're buoyant. They float up in the water column. They don't have to have something that keeps that plant erect and defying gravity all the time to get it closer to sunlight. But we've seen problems with nutria. We've seen problems with deer, snails. Damn crayfish ate my dissertation. But the way that we go about managing herbivory is building any of a number of these exclosure structures. And there's a bunch of different types of structures that you can use under different water conditions. We've had very, very good luck with some of the tray cage designs, and we'll talk about some of these designs here in a minute. The one thing that's really important is that the mesh that you use be a vinyl-coated galvanized mesh. Again, one of the mistakes that we made initially was thinking that galvanized metal, galvanized fencing would last in a reservoir. We went out, we built our exclosures, we filled them with plants, they started doing really well. We came back a year later, and the part of that exclosure that's above the water column looks great. And we pull up and all the plants are gone. And we think, what happened here? And when you look underneath the water, to where you've had that fluctuating water level, you know, the year previous, all the mesh is gone. It's just been eaten totally away. So be sure that you're using a vinyl-coated mesh. There's a number of sizes. We've had pretty good luck with the 2x4. There's some 2x2 meshes available, and there's even some coated crab pot wire. So it's like a coated chicken wire that works quite well. But there are a number of designs that we can use. You can use hoop cages. You can use cove and shoreline fences, ring cages, tray cages, and pens. The pens are something that we found that have been that have worked out quite well for us. We use an 8x16-foot pen. We can set that up perpendicular to the water line, and that allows us to chase our water levels a little bit. You can have part of that pen that stays in 2 feet of water, part of the pen in 4 feet of water. If you're using a 6-foot mesh, it works out quite well. Tray cages are nice if you've got a situation where, again, that's going to be in the public eye. You can very well protect the basal meristem of some of the species that grow in that form using one of these tray cages. Monitoring and maintenance. You can't assume that you're going to go out, you're going to build these exclosures, you're going to plant them, and you can walk away. You've got to maintain what you've got out there, and you've got to monitor what you've got out there. You may have, for one reason or another, some of the plants that you put in the substrate die fairly rapidly after you put them in. If you don't go back there in a couple of weeks and evaluate, you've lost the season. So go back, evaluate how many of those pots that you may have to replace. You've got to be willing to make repairs to those exclosures. Stuff floats through them. You're going to have logs and stuff come through. You'll have water skis come through. You'll have anglers that come up and tie to them because they see those plants there and they want to fish around those plant colonies. So some maintenance is going to be necessary. But you also want to monitor those. You want to see whether you're getting expansion of your plants fairly rapidly and do something about it that first season and not lose that season. So in kind of a summary of what we've talked about so far, you want to choose your plants wisely, you want to choose your sites wisely, and you want to install your plants wisely. Now, that being said, this is not an instantaneous thing. Typically, we don't see a lot of expansion beyond those caged colonies for about 3 to 7 years. You may have satellite colonies that are establishing in other parts of the water, the other parts of the reservoir, but they're not going to be large enough to where you can really see them readily. After 3 to 7 years, you'll be able to go out and wander around, typically upwind of where your colonies are, and you'll be able to perceive the growth of these things. The other thing is there's a threshold that you've got to achieve to where your plants are growing faster than the consumption by the herbivores that are there. And particularly in a situation where you've done some kind of aquatic plant control of an exotic species, if that's been there for 3 or 4 years, you've built up an herbivore bank that's fairly substantial. they're going to be looking for a lot of these species. So don't expect it to instantaneously colonize the whole reservoir. It may take a few years. But if you do this correctly, you do monitor and maintain and make corrective actions as necessary, you'll have success. You'll see this in the long run. So with that, I'd like to take any questions that you might have.
That was quick.
Tom.
Hey, Rick. Thanks for your leadership on this in our state. I just wanted to make a comment about the cages. We learned a lot from Rick and apply this in my district in Texas at Possum Kingdom. One of the things that on those cages, though, we had issues, and you may have issues, in working with your controlling authorities on putting those cages out there.
It's true.
There's a lot of folks that don't like T-post. A lot of us biologists don't care much for T-post out in the water either. But there is a... I'm not recommending any company, but you may look at a group called Pasture Pro, mm-hmm. and we got these posts that are very flexible, and they're designed for horses to be able to fall on them and not hurt the horse and pop right back up for a fence. That's what they're designed for.
And we've had some controlling authorities that have required us to use PVC pipe as the upright structure instead of the T-posts, and it's actually very cost-effective. A lot of it's going to depend on what kind of substrate you've got, because if you've got a fairly hard and rocky substrate, you may not be able to use some of these softer posts. But again, a lot of those different structural materials are really up to what you've got available to you locally. Now, there is a handbook that the department has actually prepared that's going to be available through the website. Craig had mentioned to me this morning that the URL for that particular notebook is going to be available on the website here for RFHP, and I highly encourage you to go to that. It's got a lot more detail than I can do in a presentation like this morning, but again, it defines the way a lot of these structures are constructed. It defines the importance of the flange at the bottom of those fences. We didn't talk about it much this morning, but typically what we'll try to do is bend that material down to the bottom and out toward the outside to develop a flange that keeps herbivores from burrowing under it and things like that. I think Tom was next. Tom up here. Oh, okay.
To an extent, it determines whether or not you can be successful with this.
It does, certainly. If you've got a lot of carp, whether they're grass carp or German carp in that system, it's going to be more difficult. Most of our native fishes, at least the Centaurcids that we deal with typically in Texas, don't consume a lot of the plant material directly. They're in there to consume the invertebrates that are consuming that plant material. But we have seen some instances where they're influencing the biota enough through causing additional turbidity and things like that it does make you sub-select the species that you're going to use. And in a system where you do have a lot of carp and that water is extremely turbid, a floating leaf species or one of the emergent species, just to get them up to the sunlight.
You know, you and I just recently talked about using chain link and the water willow and laying that down.
Mm-hmm.
And I was always in the impression that galvanized was going to last for a long time. I think in this case, you know, putting the water willow on the ground of the lake, the bed of the lake, and putting the chain link over it, letting it establish, and if the galvanized goes away, that's good news.
That's true, and what Tom's referring to is with water willow, because it's got adventitious roots that grow at the different nodes up the plant. One of the techniques that we've used with that is to lay it horizontally down on a mud flat and just hold it in contact of the substrate with either chain link or some of the same mesh material. Only takes a couple of weeks. It'll form adventitious roots down into the substrate, and you can remove that fencing material that's held it in contact with the substrate. Again, in a situation like that, we would want to remove whatever we've got. The problem that we had with a lot of the galvanized material is because you'd have sharp pieces that were left when the rest of that material eroded away. There was a safety hazard involved there that I don't think that we'd want to endure. Like I say, in terms of the way we've been doing that, we only leave the mesh down for about 2 weeks. So by that time, we don't really have too much trouble getting it back out. Steve?
Rick, can you talk about the scale of the project? How much of the reservoir have you been able to affect? And second, I suspect you started this to make some change on the fish assemblage or some aspect of the mm-hmm. fish assemblages. And what has the vegetation done for the reservoir in terms of the fish assemblage?
We probably haven't been as good at doing long-term evaluations of the fish assemblages after the establishment of these colonies. We've been really spending more of our effort at evaluating the establishment themselves with the assumption that that benefit is going to come. Now, qualitatively, we hear from the anglers that when we've got these plant communities that have developed, the fishing gets better. And we can see that through our creel surveys. But our sampling, because we're doing it at least in my branch, is more for assessment of the sport species that are there. We're not as concerned about what the overall species assemblage is as the effect that it has on the sport species that we're the most concerned about. In terms of scale, it depends on what you're trying to accomplish. One of the things that we've found that seems to work the best is to pick one fairly small cove. It may be 50 to 100 acres. Get your population, your plant community established there first. If you have success at that scale, then you select some other areas and go and do the same thing. You can use that small-scale operation as a way to sell the idea to your partners. You can take your partners out there, you can show them those successes, and you can tell them what they can help you with. And that's when your Friends of Reservoirs groups then get kind of fired up. You can go to them and say, okay, we've done this at this cove, let's pick another cove and do that and hopscotch from there. The other thing that we've tried to do is do our initial establishment at the end of the reservoir that your summertime prevailing wind action will redistribute those propagules throughout the rest of the system. So in a lot of cases, we'll start at the south end of a particular body of water, assuming that southerly breeze during the summer is going to disperse those propagules northward. And we've had pretty good success with that.
Is there any hope for us out west with some of these humongous water level fluctuations?
No, y'all are screwed. Some of the species will do well. Some of the emergent species I think you can establish, and most of them will do quite well in moist soil areas. If you don't have the ability to keep, 6 or 8 inches of moist soil underneath these things, then it's going to be a lot more difficult. The thing that we find that gives us the best indication of whether you're going to have success is looking at your Secchi visibility and looking at your annual fluctuation. If your Secchi visibility is within 2 times of what your annual fluctuation is, in other words, if you have annual fluctuation of 6 feet and your Secchi visibility is less than 3 feet, you can probably establish most of the submerged species. If it gets beyond that, then you're going to have to use, just the emergent species or, experiment with some of the lilies and things like that. It's going to be tough. It's going to be tough.
One more question?
Okay.
So out west here with the water level fluctuations, if you establish, say, 1 year of vegetation and then the water level goes down, and of course, you have these patterns up and down mm-hmm. every year. I don't know much about the seeds or the whatever they have to reestablish. But can it reestablish on its own
yes,
every
year? Yes, it can.
Year?
And one of the things that we really stress is the importance of leaving those exclosures out there long term. Just because you've got a particular species that's expanded beyond an exclosure, you don't want to remove it, because if you do have environmental conditions later on that are somewhat stressful, you may have that plant community pushed back just to your exclosures by the impact of herbivory, and it'll come back from there. Most of these species have got mechanisms that allow them to go through periods of senescence, whether it's dry or whether it's wintertime or other things like that. If you've gone through a full growing season and they've gone through their entire reproductive cycle, most of them will come back. And what we see is, even in situations where we've had bad drought for a year or 2 years, you come back after the water level has come back up, and lo and behold, the species that you planted is popping back up inside those exclosures again because you had the propagules in the hydrosoil. Yes?
I think we're going to have to take the rest of questions offline just to keep...
over beers later.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, Rick. Our next speaker is Kayla Scarafiotti. Did I say that correctly?
All right. That's probably my East Coast being able to cipher that. Kayla will be talking today. She comes to us from Ruidoso High School in New Mexico. How was that? All right. She will be talking to us today about enhancing structure and function of the shoreline zone at Elephant Butte Reservoir. Kayla?
Hi, my name is Kayla Scarafiotti. I'm a science teacher at Ruidoso High School. I teach biology 4 times a day and other classes every year. I've taught everything from ecology to geology, astronomy. I've taught science competition classes like MESA, which is math, engineering, and science achievement. And this year they threw a new one at me. I'm teaching physics and chemistry. So a wide span of students and ability levels, anywhere from squirrely freshmen to bored seniors. I met Mr. Earl Conway several years ago. He and my husband were bass fishing tournament partners. And of course, Earl is always fundraising for his projects at Elephant Butte Lake. And he brought a case of oil to the house. And he got to the house at 6 a.m. So he sat down with breakfast with us, and we started talking about how to get kids involved with restoring Elephant Butte Lake. Now, I'm always looking for projects for kids. Anything that's hands-on, anything that's kind of exhausting to take the energy level down, anything that involves the scientific method. So this project seemed perfect for my students. Mr. Earl, as the kids refer to him, has come to the classroom and talked to them, got them really excited about the project, and then reality set in. And how do you do a project when you live 3.5 hours away from the lake? We had to do some fundraising, we had to do some adjusting of the project. But first of all, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about what Earl is trying to do at Elephant Butte Lake. Oh, that's the pointer. And the go button is the green one. Where do I point? There we go. Got it. Okay, so as we've heard, out west, Elephant Butte Lake is the typical old lake syndrome. It's got rocky shores, massive amounts of soil erosion. To begin with, even when it was a new lake, there wasn't a whole lot of woody structure, either simple or complex. And now there is almost no shoreline vegetation. heavy, heavy sediment loads, irrigation drawdowns every year that are intense. TRC, Truth or Consequences, uses the lake as a municipal source of water, and we have a really poor prey base. Trying to get public involvement has been hugely successful. Everyone wants to help. And trying to find jobs for everyone to do is a real challenge. We've had the community of Truth or Consequences get incredibly involved. Strangers just walk up and say, "What are you doing?" And we give them a job. We're trying some very innovative experiments and climate change adaptations that are related directly to the desert. Trying to grow plants in a desert old reservoir, high irrigation use is challenging. As Mr. Earl says, he never does anything easy. Our students are come from a wide range of backgrounds, and some of the most exciting benefits from this are not only that you're keeping them busy and you're teaching them the scientific method, but you connect with them at a much, much deeper level. One of my teaching joys was this kid showed up on my doorstep without a jacket, and I live on a mountain. So I invited him in, found out he was from California. When he was working on our projects, he told me his story. And his story involved hiding in a trash can at a bus station in LA because he was trying to get away from a gang. And he wouldn't let me take any pictures of him because he didn't want to be identified on any website. He was terrified that someone would find him. But he's the hardest working kid that you can possibly imagine. He graduated last spring. He just got to complete his basic training in the Marines. And he invited me to his pinning ceremony so that I could pin him. Awesome. We have volunteers from everywhere, like I said. Bass Nation members have been very, very supportive and active in the project. My high school students, I have 160 students a day every year. We have the Duke City Bass Bums, the Elephant Butte community, American Fisheries Societies, students from New Mexico State drive up and help out. We are partners with the Reservoirs Fish Habitat Partnership and the New Mexico Game and Fish Department. I'm kind of related to the Game and Fish Department in that I married a game warden 30 years ago, and he's a fisheries biologist. So he's also very, very involved with law enforcement in his career, so I know both sides of game and fish. We've had a lot of contributors. Earl is an awesome grant-writing individual. He's gotten the Toyota Together Green Fellowship. He talked Shimano into $5,000 donation. Fish America Foundation, Fishing and Mossback Fish Habitats, and I apologize, I think I corrected that Fishing because I thought it was a spelling error. Sorry about that. And then we even had local companies like the Thomas Chemical Fertilizer Company who donated semi-trucks to haul Christmas trees down for a structure project. Our new normal at Elephant Butte Lake is very challenging. Back when I was a kid growing up in New Mexico, going to the lake, it was 35 miles long, and you didn't notice the drawdowns every year because the surface area was so huge. Now we're dealing with a very small mud puddle, and you see 25 to 30 foot drops every year. And this constant fluctuation in completely leached out soils are really challenging to grow. We are trying a technique that's kind of new. We're chasing the shoreline. So our projects are started in June when they start to release water out of the lake, and we plan our planting projects as the water walks down the shoreline. That way, we're planting in soils that are very damp. We're trying to provide lots of material that holds moisture for the plants to get started in. And my students have developed a soil mixture that seems to be beneficial to getting plants established. The objective is to create that new lake effect so that when the water does come back, there's vegetation on the shores that's holding the soil, preventing erosion, and then putting structure for fish to use both as fry and as adults. We've got soils that are nothing but sand over 40% of the lake, and so challenging in seed selection, challenging in establishing these seeds. And then we have people. They're part of the problem, and we're hoping that they can be part of the solution. Part of the problem is it's the only body of water within 2 hours of Albuquerque, so on a holiday weekend, you can have 150,000 people camping around a mud puddle. They will strip every scrap of wood they can find for campfires. They'll dig things up. They run over everything. and then they get stuck in the sand and have the trucks have to come pull them out, and they tear more things up. However, if you look at them from a possible labor source, and you handed a bucket of seed balls to every volunteer that came to the lake, you've solved a lot of very expensive planting by using the weekend warriors. In a minute, I'll explain how some of my students turned this idea into a possible business plan. The current vegetation, there's lots of gooding willows up at the top of the lake in the mudflats, and we've used that as cutting sources to propagate gooding willows. The really cool part about this species is that even when they've been submerged for months, they come back from the root system and reestablish very quickly. Have kind of a nasty situation with cockle burrs. It's green. We're going for anything green. So if it grows, keep it. However, the tourists don't like it. And what my students found is that cockle burrs produce an allopathogenic toxin. They outcompete everything else. And when we planted our seed balls in areas where there were cockle burrs, the cockle burrs won. So this is the lake. We have a whopping 114,000 acres of shoreline to plant. Some areas are very steep and very rocky. In the slide here, the light blue area is areas that have vehicle access, and then we have competition from the weekend warriors. So where we're kind of looking at to plant, at least for our field trials, is the east side of the lake over here, where there's not a lot of access for tourists. We've tried lots of traditional approaches. 2,000 Christmas trees were sank last year in pallet structures. Unfortunately, with the lake drawdown this year, they are now high and dry. However, I did give the assignment to some of my young men who have severe ADHD, the task of chasing crappie fry around these really shallow Christmas trees. They captured several different species, sunfish, crappie, little bass, and they had a blast doing it. We've tried portable habitats, plastic matrix habitats. I am really curious to see Earl's backyard because it's got to be the largest junk pile that you can imagine. And he has numerous ideas as an engineer of how to get fish structure in the water. His latest creation is called the tarantula. Big old black thing that has a floating island on top with bass structure and attractors underneath. This is going to be launched this spring, and hopefully I will have plants out of my classrooms to provide for the top. Other ideas? We're building blue cat houses. Hopefully the catfish will like our structures and inhabit them. We have quite a number of catfish enthusiasts in the TRC area, and so they're really excited about launching these this spring. The rock stars are something for our smallmouth bass population, and hopefully with a little bit of GoPro technology, we can monitor these. Other innovative ideas. The stiff floating island structures grew plants really, really well, and some of the bass clubs who had adapted a cove and adopted it to make these improvements were very successful, until the weekend warriors hit them with their boats or tied up to them. And we also had a really, really severe storm this fall, and downdraft annihilated one of our marinas, and it also created so much wave action that it lifted some of these islands up onto the shore. One of the Eagle Scouts in TRC came up with this soft island idea. It has a foam underneath that keeps it floating, but the top is very loose and squishy, and the ducks and geese don't like it. They don't like that movement, so they have left the plants alone, and it's very cheap to produce. So we got away from having to cover all of our islands with chicken fencing to keep the ducks and geese out, and it's growing yellow nutsedge really well. The Eagle Scouts in TRC are really, really active. They've done things like when we sank our Christmas trees, couldn't afford the block, but with that 40% shoreline of sand, they filled thousands of sandbags and sank our Christmas trees with sandbags. Other innovative projects that we've got going. These are buffalo gourds, which in New Mexico are everywhere. If you stuff them full of cow manure and seeds, they make a perfect little greenhouse for your seeds. And we've been very successful in getting several of the sedge species to sprout in buffalo gourds. We are planting the breakwater tires with potted plants so that the roots grow down and the plants grow up, and then we avoid confrontations with all the boaters. We're also trying little egg carton greenhouses, and this is where my students came into play and developed a soil base that's helped the plants get established. I've always done a project called a Winogradsky column, which involves using sediment off of our pond out in front of our high school to mix with the soil to get bacteria established, create a nitrogen cycle within their little terrarium. We added shredded newspaper for a carbon source, and when eggs fall off the truck at Walmart, they bring them to my classroom, and we're using the egg yolks as a sulfur source. So they mix all that into the potting soil, put it in an egg carton, soak the carton so that it's really, really moist, and then we go out and chase the shoreline down. So lots of cool ideas come from kids. Sometimes it's a little hard to get them to settle down and focus, but every now and then you get the kid that won't let go of an idea until he makes it work. So this is our reality. We have 114,000 acres of experimental surface. And in 2012, the lake was at its lowest point. It has come back up slightly. We had one of the wettest years ever in New Mexico this year, which was such a blessing. But at the same time, the water was so attractive, the irrigation district really intensely drew the lake down again. How to get kids involved? It's very frustrating to work with high school students. It's very frustrating to work with public school districts. It's very challenging just to get started. And what Mr. Earle provided for me personally was startup supplies. I needed grow lights, I needed potting soil, I needed shelving to put the plants on, and I needed seeds. So getting the right kind of seeds was also a real challenge. We started with a company called Plants of the Southwest. Didn't really have the right seeds, and what we did this summer was actually go out to the lake, gather the native seeds that are already out there, and bring them home and use them this year. Kids are amazingly innovative. This young woman on the right created a wave tray, scrap from a leftover earthquake simulator that was found in the back closet, and rocked her seeds, imitating the wave action, trying to get four-winged saltbush to sprout on a sandy beach. Other kids came up with ideas for a seed ball that floats so that anglers can throw them off their boat. They float back into the coves, and as the water level drops, they park on the shoreline. Even my Christmas present last year, I'm a real avid gardener, and I got a roll of cornstarch compost bags in my stocking last year for Christmas. And so I brought that to the classroom and let them use it as a material that holds moisture in their seed balls. Testing in my classroom went great. We had a lot of different seed types that sprouted in playground sand and in a 50-pound bag of clay. The ideas that they came up with to get them to sprout were wonderful. We did have a couple of disasters. One involved my husband, and that would be D-Day, not the World War II version, but divorce. He made the comment as we were driving home from Albuquerque, "Was I supposed to water your plants?" Yeah. So we had a few losses throughout the year. But it was very successful by combining two different competitions. Kids in my biology classes were raising plants. Kids in my Mesa Club were in a competition called InnoVenture. This is a project sponsored by the New Mexico State Arrowhead Entrepreneur Center. And the idea is to combine engineering projects and then turn them into a business. So these three young women started a company that they named ProTerra Nova, and they used their seed project in my biology class to design a business. They did very, very well. They got their project plants to grow. They got their a marketing plan. They designed a business structure. And they created a way to connect with ecotourism. Part of their business plan is to educate the public, the weekend warriors, about how to plant. They designed a little sand bucket to give to kids for planting. One of the girls is an artist, and she illustrated a children's book to give to kids on why we're doing this, so that when these tourists are out there on the beach for the weekend, they have the opportunity to teach their kids about environmental protection, environmental ways that we can help redesign our reservoirs. This is the planting crew. I also call them the four squirrels. Very energetic youngsters. They're all freshmen this year. Got them up at 4 o'clock in the morning, drove them to the lake, and we started planting. And we planted in different areas of the lake, both on the tourist side and on the east side of the lake, to see if we had more success. We're planting in coves that are also supported by all the bass clubs. So we get the kids out there, we let them plant, and then the fishermen, as they're going out, they're helping monitor our progress and see if we're successful, see if we're getting any growth or improvement on the shoreline. Planting in the mud flats, they had a blast, we had a mud fight. Their little transects were really well identified. But the problem was the drawdown was so intense, the water went away really quickly, and had trouble on the mud flats, much more successful on the sandy shores. We did have other competition and predation issues, this being the wettest year in New Mexico history. The deer mice population just exploded. And we planted in late summer when the population was at the highest. So if you notice, all our little seed bags got ripped open and they ripped off all our seeds to boot. So in addition, the cornstarch film that we used did not degrade as fast as we'd like it to on a sandy shore. It degraded really well on the mudflats. So we still have a lot of work to do. We still have a possibility for experimentation is endless. And I'm really enjoying the opportunity to work with kids. We have 21 new plant species that we are experimenting with this year. Like I said, we went out and gathered native seeds. We're really dependent upon the ability to find time to teach these things. A couple of years ago, I attended a biology teacher convention and went to a workshop called Evolution Across the Curriculum. And so in order to find time to experiment with plants all year long, I'm using the desert plants to teach cell structure and adaptation and evolution and genetics and classification so that I can justify teaching 40 different standards while doing this project. And that's a real struggle when you're trying to work with teachers. We have such a wide variety of standards that we are responsible for teaching. And now that we have added pressure on us to teach to the test and teach and get kids to pass, teachers are stressed. They just, you know, they get started and they give up. And it's really, really difficult to find the right person to work with. And what's even more discouraging, at New Mexico State University graduation last spring, they graduated 5 science teachers. So the idea that young and energetic teachers are coming up through the ranks is a little scary. They're just not out there. But if you look hard, you can find teachers like myself who would rather be outside, rather be working with projects, get dirty, have their classrooms total disaster areas, and enjoy the kids. So keep trying, don't give up on us, and please keep kids involved. Are there any questions?
Questions for Kayla?
Were you able to test the buffalo gourd?
Oh, yes.
Seed bank?
Yeah. In the sandy soil, it did very, very well. I'm not sure whether it was the cow manure base or whether it was just the fact that we got a rainstorm at the right time. But we had them loaded with alkali saccatone grass, and they did really well. In addition, this year, one of our seeds that we're trying to propagate are buffalo gourds. Just gather them along the highways as we go to the lake and take them to the lake as a native plant to hold soil. We haven't tried them in the clay mud flats yet, but we'll give it a shot.
So what germinated is still doing well, too?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. We've got a good grass stand. We put our buffalo gourds in rows with markers. We were hoping to use Google Earth as, you know, a monitoring system, but it just wasn't fine enough resolution to see what was going on. So that's when we got the local anglers involved and assigned them areas to go by and check it out for us. Problem was, the water dropped so fast that what we planted in August is now 35 feet from the water line. So it's you got to find the right anglers that'll get out of the boat and go take pictures for you.
Well, very neat work. Thank you.
All right.
So you have to have a plant that grows to maturity.
Hold on 1 second.
So you have to plant a plant that germinates, grows to maturity, and seeds within like 2 weeks?
As the water level goes through it. That's what we worked on this year. We worked with the very fast germinating seeds. We got sprouts coming out of our seed balls in playground sand in 2 days. This year we're focusing on other more woody structure plants. One of the things that is the most beautiful thing I've ever seen is a dahlia, a desert dahlia, and it is a real bushy structure that traps blowing sand, creates its own little wall for catching water, provides lots and lots of shelter, and if and when the water does come back up, it would provide a lot of structure for fish. So it's a work in progress. We're trying things that are immediate solutions and plants for the long term as well.
Kayla, you're a jackie of all trades and obviously an awesome teacher. Is there any way to take your experiences and turn it into, or maybe it's already been done, turn it into a website that could be made available to other high school teachers through perhaps some of the high school organizations or perhaps through the RFHP website to encourage similar efforts elsewhere?
I'd love to. I have several students that are computer tech orientated and play with websites, but to tell you the truth, I just haven't had time. But that's a great idea, and it would keep them busy. So,
yes. You had a question. You talked about the soil moisture or soil mixture that you had come up with that was ideal. Could you give more details on that?
Like I said, the idea came from a Winnow Gradsky column, and I'd done this project with students many, many times so that they see over the school year the colonization of different bacteria that you find in sediments. Those bacteria, most of them are anaerobes, and can survive in really extreme conditions. We added that to our soil mixture so that it would help cycle the carbon, the nitrogen, and the sulfur that we provided. Makes a really nice, good black matrix for them. The students also used a recycled carpet material as a structure for the seeds to sprout in, again, helping to hold moisture, helping to contain and use the nutrients that we provided better.
Time for one more. Anybody? Jeff, now's your opportunity. I cut you off
last
time.
Well, thank you guys very much. I appreciate the opportunity, and I really appreciate what Earl has done for me in my classroom. The opportunity was great. Thank you.
Thanks, Kayla. Our next talk comes to you from Utah. Eric Wagner is a researcher at our Fisheries Experiment Station here in the state, and he will be presenting the effect of overwinter hydration, temperature, photo period, water depth, and scarification on seed germination of 12 aquatic wetland plant species. That's why you couldn't remember it, because it was about 40 words long. Yeah. Here you go, Eric.
All right, I first like to start by recognizing my co-authors, Randy Opfinger, who is also here, played a key role in this experiment, as well as Gavin Johnson, who is our technician with the program. So the goal of the project was fairly broad. We wanted to provide fish habitat and reservoirs, and of course they're fluctuating in most reservoirs that we have here in Utah. And more specifically, we were interested in trying to figure out the best way to germinate seeds so that we could use those to start the aquatic plant process going. And in order to do that, we wanted to evaluate some of the variables that were involved, which included wet vernalization, which is the basically overwinter storage of the seeds under cold conditions. So that's the vernal part. And that tells the seed, okay, we've just gone through winter and now we're ready for germination in the spring. We additionally looked at temperature, water depth, photo period, seed age, and scarification. And scarification is basically a mechanism for treating the outside of the seed so that we either nick it with a physical mechanical abrasion, or we can do it chemically with bleach. And so that'll be some of the treatments we'll look at here in a bit. So when I first started on this project, we wanted to figure out what we wanted to use for plants. And so initially we went through and looked at the Intermountain Herbarium Network and other sources to figure out what species we wanted to work with. And I definitely want to give thanks to that herbarium network that's run by USU. There's also other universities that are involved that provide data to that. So it's an online resource. It's worked out well. So in the fall of 2013, we started with a project. We started with some seed collection in Utah. We did a literature review of fish habitat improvement, which I do have a few copies that are out on the table out back if anybody wants copies of the fish habitat or the review that I did that's out there. Another seed source we got was from Granite Seed, which is a company in Lehi, which is here in Utah. And with that, we got started on our projects. The plant species that we ended up with, there's Polygonum amphibium, which is pondweed, a couple of bulrush species, another spike rush. We do have a few carex species, Alyssma graminium, which was the water plantain we were able to get from our Newton Reservoir, which is up in Cache Valley, and another grass, which is the Alopocurus aequalis. I'll give a brief introduction to some of these plants, if you're not familiar with those. This is Johnson Reservoir down in southern Utah, and we have a pretty good stand of the Polygonum amphibium. This is where we got our seed source from. Although not really a wetland, or not really an aquatic plant per se, Polygonum pennsylvanicum grows pretty well in the area, and we see it in some of the reservoirs where there's moist soil, and the seeds do provide food for waterfowl, and they do colonize pretty well in the upland areas of the reservoir. And that was one of the thoughts, too, as we were going through our selection of possible plants was that because of the nature of the reservoirs that we have and the fluctuations that we experience, that a large percentage of the time, maybe 50-70% of the time, those reservoir edges are going to be out of the water. So we need to pick plants that were going to be out of the water more than they were in, just because of the way the reservoirs are operated. And so these species could potentially fill that need. A few other ones we looked at, Ethiocaris, Palustris, a couple of the rushes. There's the bulrush species that we have there. And the juncus species, we looked at four different ones there. We have Tenuis, Encifolius, Balticus, which tends to be fairly wide in distribution, and Torii were the four species of rushes. And we got all those from the Granite Seed Company. Nebraska sedge, we also got from them. The Carex atherides, we collected ourselves. This is some of the plants that we got it from there at Silver Lake in Utah. All right, so we did two different experiments. One of them we did over the winter in 2014, and another one in 2015. We'll start with the first one. We had 12 species that we looked at in that one. And the experimental design that we used for that experiment was we had two different winter storage treatments, so we wanted to see if dry storage or wet storage was going to work better. We knew from the literature review that I had done that winter storage was something we needed to do to help with the seed germination, so we did that. The temperature treatments for germination, we looked at four fixed temperatures, and then we had three fluctuating temperature treatments that you see up there. And they range anywhere from the 19 to 27 C on the upper end. Additionally, for some species, we also added the scarification treatment. These were especially for the seeds that had hard the pericarps on them, like the Scirpus species, or the Schoenoplectus now, and the Polygonum amphibium. So for the treatments that we did there, we had a bleach treatment for either 1 day or 5 days, and this was based on data that we found in the literature on the treatment. And we also tried mechanical abrasion. And for the mechanical abrasion, we used on the right side there, we built a container that basically a PVC pipe that we taped emery cloth down on the bottom, and then we would rub the seeds on that emery cloth within that container for about 3 minutes as a standard, and we do that for 3 minutes to get the edges roughed up, and then we put them into the petri dishes from there. Okay, so for all the seeds went into petri dishes, and we even had some that aren't shown here, so we had a hell of a lot of counting that we did, as you can see. Now we had 4 plates per treatment, 25 seeds per plate, 12-hour photo period for this first experiment. So that was standardized across all treatments there. And then we monitored the seeds for 57 days, counting the seeds every 2 days to see what had germinated. And as they germinated, we pull the seeds out. And then we transfer those to horticultural trays. And we don't have time to go over the results of that part of it, but we'll cover the germination at least. The germination chambers themselves were basically totes with a clear lid that we put on them. We used full spectrum light to put into for the photo period. For temperature control, we used recirculating heaters to control the temperature, and we also had bayonet heaters, which I don't have shown here, but they were, so for the high temperature and the low temperature fluctuations that we did, we used the immersion heater, or the recirculating heaters for the higher temperature, and then when those are turned off, then the bayonet heaters established the minimum temperatures. So. Okay, for the actual temperatures that we had, we did pretty well, we thought, in actually managing the temperatures, and thanks in large part to Randy's efforts in keeping those temperatures where they needed to be. Okay, getting the results for the first experiment, in terms of the wet versus dry storage, we found that pretty much universally, the wet storage improved germination. For some species, we didn't have very good germination at all, and so those were, didn't see any significant differences, but for the ones that we did, the wet storage helped with the germination. And not only that, it helped decrease the germination time so that when you're ready to plant the seeds, they germinate much quicker. So you can see down here that within 8 or 9 days, pretty much everything had germinated within in that time. Boy, it looks like things are really changing with the way things are laid out there. All right, for our Lissma graminium, this is the water plantain. We did do a bleach treatment on this one. We found that that did significantly improve the germination. So we recommend that as a pre-treatment of the seeds. Looking at the temperature effects, you can see that the 5-day bleach had the best germination, and we had pretty high germination in all the temperature treatments. So across the board, the best was at 20, but still no significant difference amongst all these various temperature treatments. And based on the percentages that we're getting for germination, we felt really good that this is at least one species we can go ahead with in terms of prepping the seed and being ready to go with this as applying it in the field. Unfortunately, the bulrushes didn't have as good of luck with those. We had poor germination in all the treatments. The best levels that we did see were in the bleach treatment, so that we do recommend that. And the high fluctuating temperatures did help with the germination of these, too. So that was one thing we want to pursue in the second study, which we'll see a little better results on that second study. We also had poor germination in the Polygonum amphibium. The Carex atherides is we think that perhaps the seeds were poor quality to start with, and so that could have been a problem in that particular species. Eleocharis has a thicker outer shell, so that could be part of the problem as well. So anyway, that one didn't work as well, so more work is needed with that. And this image here kind of shows just how thick those pericarps are and how difficult it is to get the germination going on that. For the Juncus species, Juncus balticus did the best. We had a variety of, you can see the germination rates here. We're better at the warmer temperatures and especially with the fluctuating temperatures and the higher temperatures. But reasonable germination there. The other species didn't do nearly as well, especially tenuous and torii, very low rates in all those. But we did get some here, and really variable in terms of the results that we got there. For Carex and Ebersensis, we did see significant differences. Whoops, go back up. There were some significant temperature effects, still pretty low overall, but best with the higher fluctuating temperatures. So not only do you have to have a higher temperature, but the fluctuation part of it really seems to be fairly important for some of these species. We did find with this particular species that the dry treatment was actually better than the wet. And we seem to see that more with the grasses and the sedges in general, that really the wet treatment of the seeds isn't as important as it is for some of the other species. They're more readily germinated. We even saw some germination within the petri dishes and the overwinter storage, even in the dark, that they were still germinating. So those, I think we can go ahead and plant those out in it pretty much immediately and have those still work for us. All right, moving on to experiment 2. We looked at seed age as a factor, trying to see just how much time that seed spent in the wet storage to see if that would help with the germination. The last segment of that, the 13-month treatment, we just started on Monday, and so that's ongoing, so we don't have any results from that, but we can give what we have so far for the up to 7 months. For the treatments that we chose in this experiment. The juncus, we tried a higher temperature than we did in the last experiment, so we went up to 32 to 38. And we also evaluated photoperiod, so we had 12 or 14 hour light. And then we had the, basically as a control for the last time, we had the 15 to 27 treatment. For the juncus species, you saw those, and then for the bulrushes, we also evaluated that same temperature. We also went to a higher temperature, the 40 to 46, based on some of the data we saw in literature, where we're seeing temperatures even up into the 50s that were helping to germinate some of those species. And we evaluated both 12, 14, and 24-hour photoperiods with that. For the polygonum, we did see some data in the literature that suggested that maybe the colder temperatures might be better for germination, so we evaluated those, which we hadn't done in the previous experiment. So looking at the full spectrum of temperature then for that. So we had 6 to 10 or 15 to 20, and we had 14-hour light for both of those. And then we also had water depth as a variable, particularly for the bulrushes, where they're seen in a little deeper water, and there was an article that suggested that maybe the water depth could be a variable that could help us with the germination there. So we tested 4 centimeters versus the ones in the petri dishes. And lastly, we had the chemical pretreatment for some of the species with the thick walls, like the polygonum and the Eleocharis. For all the bulrushes, we treated those with bleach, because based on the results we got from the last time, that we just had that as a control across all treatments. So we just learned from our previous test and applied that to this one. All right, for the results of the second experiment, then we did see significant effects of age, temperature, and water depth, and we'll get into more details as we talk about individual species. Overall, though, with a photoperiod, we didn't see any significant effects of photoperiod. The bleach effects that for the treatments that we did have a controls for, like the Polygonum pennsylvanicum, we did see a significant effect there. The other species, like Eleocharis and the Polygonum amphibium, we just had poor germination in all those, and so we weren't able to see a difference there. But that was just largely due to the poor germination rate that we got. All right, for the bulrushes, we have 32 to 38 as treatments, and again, no significant differences between the photoperiods. We did see a difference with the water depth. We had better germination. So our best germination was in these higher water depths. With a higher temperature at 40 to 46, that we had very poor germination in all these, and the ones that we did see germinate, you could see that the seedling actually died from the high temperature eventually, and so we're dropping that as a treatment in this next iteration. But it was just too hot for too long. I think a shorter duration exposure to that would be fine, but the longer durations didn't work as well. So I think if we can stick with this temperature regime, we're getting a good percentage here with the rates here. Oops. All right, for the juncus species, again, no difference with the photoperiod, but the best rates that we're seeing, I have bold here. So for in this case, if we go to 6 months at this 15 to 27, that's where we have some of our best germination. The warmer temperatures didn't do as well, and that was pretty much the case for some of these others, where the 15 to 27 gave us better rates than any of the other temperatures. We were starting to see some better germination finally in some of these other species. The best rates here were, again, in the 15 to 27 treatments. And Baltica, same story here, where the seed age made a difference here, at least giving them a couple of months in the winter vernalization stage before they were put into the, before you try and germinate them. So time zero would be in the fall, And you could still get some germination, but the best germination, again, would be after a little bit of that winter vernalization. All right, so to summarize then, our goal is to try and get these seeds prepared so that they're just within a few days of germinating when we put them out. So if we just stick seeds out there, the more opportunity there is for loss of the seeds to mice or other sources or dying, and that we're thinking that the strategy is to try and prepare the seeds so that when we put them out there, they're going to germinate within just a few days of putting them out. And so we prepare the seeds in such a way that they're hydrated and they're just ready to go. We know what the time is for them to germinate, and based on that, we'll go ahead and put those seeds out, and they'll be ready to go when we plant them. We still have some more work to do on some of the species, but I think we do have some data that will help guide the species that we work with, at least, and get those seeds out. And the wet vernalization really does make a difference and really helpful for some species. There are some species, as I mentioned, some of the grasses and the carices, that they really don't need the wet part of it, per se, but being stored cold and dry does help, and we can use those seeds to plant those directly. The bleach pretreatment was helpful, especially for our seeds that have the thick pericarps and Lissamograminium and the Pennsylvanicum and some of these other bulrushes. They have the thick seeds. That treatment is recommended and does help, and also helps cut down on some of the bacteria and fungus growth that's on the outside of the seed that might compromise embryo survival. So, you know, it's kind of a double treatment there, where you're taking off some of the wax that's on the outside of the seed, as well as killing some of the pathogens that might kill your seed as well. The temperature effects that we saw really varied with species, but in general, the fluctuating temperatures generally increased germination better than just any fixed temperature per se. So I think based on the results that we got, we have enough data to proceed at least with a few of these species that we work with, and I feel pretty confident that we can at least have enough to start to get out into the field with some experiments. So in terms of optimal conditions so far, based on our test treatments for Pennsylvanicum, we do see the 15 to 20 C after bleach pretreatment. We had 39% germination. And I think that's enough to get started with those at least. With the bulrushes, the 32 to 38 centimeters and 4 centimeters of water, we do see decent germination rates there. And then based on we did some tetrazoleum test, which is a viability test. And based on that, we're seeing that seeds have about 50 to 60% viability to start with. So that means they're a pretty significant percentage that are never going to germinate because they were bad seeds to start with. And with a junk of species, we're seeing that the 15 to 27 temperature regime works pretty well, and we're getting really good germination rates with those as well, so I think we can move ahead with those. So with that, I'll be happy to try and answer any questions you might have. Thanks for your attention.
Questions for Eric? No questions? Oh.
Chris back there.
Hold on.
Okay, I don't know where to start. I have so many questions. Where have you been all my life? I don't understand how you varied the temperature between 15 and 28 in the plastic containers. Did you use a hose that went into the containers or set the heater in the box with the plants?
Yeah, the containers had water underneath, so it was like a double box sort of thing. So they have a larger tote that has water in the bottom of it, and then a smaller tote that contains the dishes within the larger tote. And So the water is recirculating around the outside. We also had a small recirculating pump within the bottom to just keep the water going around within the tote itself so that you didn't get hot spots around the immersion heater. And that seemed to work pretty well. We had, for the higher temperature, we used the recirculating heat pump. So you'd have, you dial that temperature in, tweak that so you get to the where your target temperature is. And so that's your high point. And then you control that and shut that off with a timer. So you have that on a timer. So that shuts off. We were doing on a 12-hour cycle. So we were doing 12 hours heat, 12 hours on the off. And on the off cycle, we wanted to maintain the lower temperature. And so we used the bayonet heaters within the water down below to maintain that. You do have to keep track of the water level to make sure that your bayonet heater doesn't get too far out so you don't burn that up. So keep maintaining the water level within the outside tote was something that we did basically every 2 days as we went in and did the germination check. We would check water levels and top it off as needed.
Are there any plans for field trials next year then based on those species that you feel comfortable with?
At the moment, no. But that's part of the work that we need to do collectively within the DWR and working with our other stakeholders that are involved with us and come up with a plan. So I think Craig's supposed to be leading that effort as I understand it. So.
I'll get to it, I promise.
You had a question over here.
Rick.
You know, given that the Polygonium species are so readily consumed by waterfowl, do you think that your germination might have improved if you tried scarification with a mild acid solution to mimic gut contents rather than using the bleach?
Yeah, we did scarification on the initial experiment one, and at least based on what we did anyway, it didn't work as well, and we still didn't get any germination. So it's possible we need to be more vigorous, or you know, try another alternative to get them to germinate. I have some additional ideas I want to try out. I bought some enzymes from Sigmund Aldrich to try and look at maybe using enzymatic treatment to help break down some of that outer cellulose layers on those pericarps and try and use that to basically pre-treat the seeds and soften that outside shell enough so that water imbibition gets into where the embryo is and gets that germination going. Another thought I had is maybe looking at pressure and using pressurize them and then depressurize them quickly enough that you basically pop crack the pericarp enough that you get the break that's enough for the water to get into the embryo and start that germination process. So more work to do in that regard, but just haven't had time to get to it.
That's some really nice experimental groundwork before you do the field work. One of the things that I noticed was that you were using the 5% level in the statistics, and it seems that that's a little bit too restrictive. You may be limiting yourself and you may be throwing out treatments that may be useful given that some of the stuff that you're doing, it really doesn't cost you that much. Like for example, the chlorine treatment, I'm guessing that treating the seeds with chlorine is not really expensive and it doesn't take a whole lot of time. So perhaps you could back out to say the 10, 20, or even 50%. You know, if there's a 50% chance that it helps and it doesn't cost anything, then why throw it away at the 5% level? So that was just a comment.
Yeah, I think the bleach treatments will definitely be helpful for those species with the thick shells. And some of the grass species that have a little thinner pericarps, I'd be a little more nervous about using that and a little harder to deal with it. And the jungle species, those seeds are so small,
that I'm reluctant to use it on those per se, just for the logistics of actually trying to do it, because the seeds are like powder.
Any other questions for Eric? Okay, thank you, Eric.
All right, thanks for your attention.
Next up is Tom McDonough.
And Tom comes to us from the Lake Livingston Friends of Reservoirs. And he will be talking to us today about reestablishing native vegetation in Lake Livingston, Texas, through partnerships. Tom?
Where do I point it?
This is, yeah.
Okay.
Anywhere, really.
Okay.
And then this is back, and then this is your laser.
Okay.
Gotcha.
Thank you. Well, my presentation is going to be short as we're waiting for it to come up. I'm Tom McDonough, and I'm working on a project with Lake Livingston, and my background is computer engineer, financial advisor, and now, what am I now? I'm a volunteer. I'm a volunteer and puts in a lot of time working on a project here at Lake Livingston. I am also a member of Texas Black Bass Unlimited. Texas Black Bass, next year, 30 years that we've been working with Texas Parks and Wildlife on different projects. And I think we've been a real good partner with Texas Parks and Wildlife.
Very good.
And Texas Parks and Wildlife on this project has been my point source for getting this going. My wife and I are both master gardeners and master naturalists, but that doesn't make us experts, okay? We toy at it. And we do have a large project on Lake Livingston. It's a very aggressive project. If people that know me, if we're going to do something, we're going to be aggressive at it, okay? And we're going to try to get it done, you know, in the shortest amount of time we can possibly do it. And I guess we can just take a little break here and wait. Here it is, right here. And our motto is bringing Lake Livingston back to life. Lake Livingston is absolutely devoid of any plant life except some non-native plants that are currently being sprayed. And so one of the things that we're going to talk about is, this is a 43-year-old lake, and I'm a tournament fisherman, and I've been fishing this lake probably for 40 years. And it's a great bass fishery if you know where to go. It's but it has deteriorated. The counts of crappie and bass are on the decline. It's a great catfish lake, and it's a great striped bass lake, and it's a great white bass lake. But other than that, we are and the decline in the game fish, what I call the game fish. And as a project director for this thing, we have two managing partners on this, Texas Black Bass Unlimited, which I'm part of, and the Master Naturalist, the Piney Woods Lake Master Naturalist. I don't know how many of you in other states have Master Naturalists in them. Are anybody familiar with the Master Naturalists in their states? They're a great source of volunteers. They're all You can recognize him. Got all white hair, okay? Or no hair. And so the, but we managed this project in conjunction with each other. And this project was approved by Texas Parks and Wildlife and the Trinity River Authority. It's two different government agencies that control this lake. Our project description is to restore the lost habitat. And as Rick mentioned, water willow is our plant. And I did not choose that plant. That was a plant that Texas Parks and Wildlife chose. And it's very easy to work with, okay? And so we can grow it rapidly and we can get it commercially. Our key goals are to reduce shoreline erosion, which we have a lot of. We have very large wave action in the lake. We have a lot of turbidity. We want to improve the filtration of the water. When I fished this lake 30, 40 years ago, you could see a spinnerbait coming through the water 3 to 4 feet under the water. Today, you can't even see a spinnerbait coming through the water at 6 inches at times. Sometimes you think you can step out of your boat and walk on the water. It's get so muddy. So we are doing that. We're trying to improve the habitat primarily for game fish, but as mentioned by Rick, is that it's good for the birds, it's good for the reptiles. We used to have a lot of frogs on this lake. We don't have any frogs anymore. The tadpoles are eaten up before they're just gone. You know, very rarely do you see a frog on this 85,000 acre lake. It's the second largest lake in Texas, and it's a constant level lake, which I know some of you would love to have a constant level lake, but then it presents problems. And one of the reasons we don't get a lot of growth in the water is because we don't get a chance, we don't have drawdowns, and we don't get beanie bushes like other lakes do and stuff like that. When the water comes back up, it provides habitat for the fish. So we also used to have very large tournaments on this lake. Today, if you hold a tournament on this lake, you can look at the websites of people crying, why are you going to Livingston? Okay? And it's still a good bass fishery. I went out the other day for the first time in a month and a half to check the plants. I started the fishing. And I had 8 keepers within about an hour and a half. So up to 4.5 pounds. So I was happy. And you just need to know how to fish the lake. And that's with most lakes. And but the key problem we had is that we have too many white hares in the volunteer corps. And as a master gardener, I was doing a project for Livingston High School and the Livingston Intermediate School of putting native vegetation into their, on their properties. And I was talking to the superintendent who has an agricultural background. And I was telling him that my wife won't let me put 10 aquatic tanks on our property. And lo and behold, he says, Tom, I want those tanks. Well, the dumbest thing I ever asked for, the next thing, well, why would you want those tanks? 45 minutes later, I knew why he wanted them. And he says, you need to be talking to other school districts about this. You can do much more than 10 aquatic tanks. And he was right. And so we have 19 tanks installed right now. Here is the lake. We have about 450 miles of shoreline. There is a significant amount of bulkheads in it. And housing is around the lake in different parts all around the lake, but there are a lot of good areas that we can plant. We're about 80 miles north-northeast of Houston, and it has become a prime destination for people who want to come out. We have a beautiful state park, and the Trinity River Authority has a beautiful state park. And the state park in Livingston is one of the highest rated state parks in the state of Texas. And we like to think that they come out there just to see the plant life, but that's, we know that's not true. The other thing that we want to do is we want to bring these bass tournaments back. And we have gotten a commitment from a large bass tournament to come back. And but apparently their members are complaining about going to Livingston. So we're working on that. Lake Livingston Friends of Reservoir was started in 2013. Mark Webb of Texas Parks and Wildlife approached me and said, why don't you get involved in an aquatic plant project at bringing plants back in here? And I said, well, that's a big job. We're talking 85,000 acres here. And he said, well, you can do it. And I said, well, I don't think you're right, Mark. I think we're going to have a team of people to do this. And he said, well, you do whatever you need to do, but, you know, it's a good project. So we started working on the plan, and we talked to the master naturalist, and they embraced the project. And I started working with 2015, actually in 2014, I started working and enlisting school districts to get involved in this project. And they have actually really embraced this project of getting involved in restoring this lake. And because, as mentioned in New Mexico, you know, these kids love to have projects. We chose a water willow, and you've heard about the water willow. It's easy to grow. It grows rapidly, and it's a great shallow water habitat for fish, for birds, for reptiles, and our alligators. I guess our alligators will like it too, but we have lots of alligators. But they don't bother you. So who are our partners? We have 24 partners currently, and we have six schools, districts, And that is hard to manage. That is my biggest problem right there. They all have their own schedules, and they don't want to hear about your schedule. We're going to have our first second school added to a school district. Livingston Junior High School and intermediate schools are going to take on aquatic tanks also. So we're going to have now all the other tanks are located at high schools. And we live out in a rural area. Livingston is about 5,000 people. That's the biggest city out there. I work with cities that have less than 1,000 people, and they got a school district. So, you know, the Goodrich High School, I think, has 54 students. Okay, so it would be nice if I had a 6A high school with about 4,000 students in it, but I don't have that. We have state officials involved in it. We have county and local governments. We have clubs, bass clubs. We have organizations, garden clubs have all gotten involved with this. Chamber of Commerce have gotten involved in it. We have individuals, and we have the reservoir fishery habitat involvement. And the managing partners, we have distinct responsibilities and we have shared responsibilities. And I have an Air Force colonel, retired, that works with me, and he takes care of logistics and volunteers. And I usually take care of fundraising, communication, and project direction. And that's one of the things that we do. I do all the publishing. I strongly believe that you need to publish or you're going to perish. And that's how you get the word out in the community. What we've accomplished, we've been funded through 2016. I'll probably be out of money somewhere between April and September of next year. And I've applied for another grant, and I'm hoping, keeping my fingers crossed, that we'll get that grant. We have 19 tanks installed. Each tank will hold about 200 one-gallon pots, okay? And we're doing 2,000, we've completed two plantings of about 2,500 plants, and we're beginning to grow these plants in greenhouses. These schools have some greenhouses that I would die for. The Livingston Independent School District probably has $1.5 million greenhouse. Air conditioned, heated, 70 degrees year round. Shepherd has a smaller greenhouse, but it is air conditioned, 70 degrees, and heated. I have a greenhouse. It is not air conditioned, but it is heated, okay? And so I've got about 900 plants right now growing in my greenhouse. When I go back, I'm gonna go up to Dallas and pick up 1,000 plants and bring them down to seed those two greenhouses that I've got in my area with 500 plants each so they can start propagating plants. We provide all the schools with everything they need. There's no out-of-pocket money. The only thing that they have to come up with is transportation. It's not an issue because the lake's fairly close to, you know, to all those school districts. We were named in 2015 as one of the 10 top waters to watch, and I thank everybody that had anything to do with that, Fish and Wildlife and National Fish Habitat. It got a lot of local attention for us, and that's what I want. It also picked up the Chronicle in Houston when we got that, and it was the first time that we have, you know, had the 4.5 million people down in Houston, or 5.5 million, whatever it is, have an opportunity to hear about our project. The students build the tanks. They propagate the plants. They maintain them. They plant them. And I've got a video here at the end I'll show you. And we even have the special needs students involved in one school district. The students will go out and work in the greenhouse, and if they do their chores in the greenhouse, well, the teacher allows them to feed the fish, the gambusia, that we put in the tanks to hold down the mosquitoes. They get to feed them, and they love that. They think that, and they've also growing them in their classroom. So I've got a constant supply of fish coming in, okay? So that's worked out well for us. Am I hitting the wrong button? There we go. I got to go back. We have 6 more tanks on order. There's no sense in being in a rush right now, and the coal in the we're out of the growing season right now. We'll have those tanks installed probably by January the 1st. And then I'm going to be talking to some other school districts about adding some tanks also. I'd like to get up to a total of 25 aquatic tanks, which would give me the ability to have 5,000 plants to plant per planting, okay? We're looking for greater efficiency in planting these plants. And you heard me ask Rick Ott a question about galvanized fencing. There's a method to planting water willow that may really speed up the process of that. Because when you stop and think about it, we have the students for a very limited time. They've got to get back to school to be able to catch their buses. And so we have them for about 6 hours. And if we're going to plant plants, we've got to get it all done and get them fed and back on the buses and back at school in about 7 to 8 hours. And so that's one of the things that if we can come up with a faster, efficient ways of planting these water willow, then that would be great. We also built the tanks 2 feet high, as Rick mentioned, and that will allow us to branch out into some other aquatics later on. What needs to be done? We need to increase our outreach and marketing. We're working on that. We finally were funded here in August, and we've spent money on getting brochures. We've spent money on equipment to be able to go into the schools and do some projects with the schools and talk to them about habitat restoration. And we don't want to just talk about aquatic habitat. We want to talk about the whole arena of habitat. We have shoreline and boat ramp signage that needs to be done. We have tracking growth and the colonization. We're going to have site signs at each one of the sites. And we have people who have volunteered to monitor those sites, and we're setting up a system to where they can fill out a form and submit it by email so we can track that and then forward it on to Texas Parks and Wildlife. And then I'm going to continue working on fundraising because this project's about a $200,000 project. It's a 10-year project. And I just hope that I'm alive after 10 years. To see the end of it. The biggest problem we had was in our grant with getting it submitted that somebody decided that we needed to watch out for the Indian artifacts. Okay, now here's a lake, it's got 2 feet of sediment in it, okay? It's very hard to walk around in some of the areas. You know, most of the time you're standing in one place, you're sinking. And so I don't think the Indians had any burial grounds in that sediment, okay? We're taking about that much of the plant and putting it into that area. But we ended up having to have a cultural review, and we got that done through Texas Parks and Wildlife. We could have never afforded to do that on our own. I imagine Texas Parks and Wildlife paid a lot more than $200,000 to get that done. I have no idea what the cost was. But we got it done, we got approved. And we have this online on our website. We have a website, LLFOR. www.scarification.org. We're also on Facebook as of last week. But you can use Google Earth and fly around the shoreline and see where we're able to plant. The green areas were good. Yellow areas, if somebody wants to plant in there, they're going to have to hire somebody to do a survey, archaeological survey. In the red areas, there are no areas. We cannot plant there for at all. We also have to look for the Neches River firebrush water mallow. I don't understand why it grows on land. Our plants grow in the water. But if we have a mallow in the Neches River firebrush mallow on the shore, we can't plant there, okay? We got plenty of areas to plant, so it's just not worth having a discussion about that one. And this is the future of Lake Livingston, we hope. And it's becoming a real birding area. We see a lot of birders. We have a tremendous eagle population. I see coons there. I've seen all types of ducks and geese. And birders are starting to come out, and birders have money, and they spend money, and that's good for the economy. So the more that we can get the birders in here, it's better for the economy. And this is our video. And does anybody have any question before I start the video up? Okay, you want to start the video? This was done by Onalaska High School, the students in the media class, and they did this on our last planning here. During this planning. And this was done September 15th. fire chief there. This is all going on in about six different areas, but this is primarily on Alaska area that they were doing that. And they were the host high school. And so they took the videos and planning. And that's it.
Questions for Tom?
Yes.
Tom, what was the biggest challenge that you had in getting all of the schools bought into this process?
Everything was a challenge.
Are you answering?
I can't hear you. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm used to walking around on stage. The biggest challenge was the dates. You know, you would send out emails and say, we want to plant on this week, and here's an alternative week. And, I mean, it was just, you know, that you'd get these reply, but, well, we can't do it on Tuesday, but we can do it on Thursday. And then another school says, well, the only day we have available is on a Wednesday, and that. Finally, I just had to say, look, we're going to get Texas Parks and Wildlife out here once, and they're coming Tuesday. We got to do it on Tuesday. If you can make it, you can make it. If you can't, you can't, okay? And that was our biggest challenge right there, is getting, you know, dates to do that. As far as the propagations, the planting and stuff like that, I really have no problem. I ask them to tell me when I can come bring soil. I bring a cement mixer. We bring a clay sand mix, and we bring some low organic cheap soil from Walmart, right, Rick? And we mix it up, and they usually will have 25 to 50 kids out there helping us propagate the plants. We're trying to get away from the propagation by going to the greenhouse method, to where we'll just take the plugs and put them into pots. And instead of having to tear the plants apart and, you know, separating them, we just put a plant into a pot and put it in the water and go from there. And I want to get up to about 10,000 plants a year. I want to go to 3 plantings. I want to do 2 with the schools, and then I want to do 1 in the summertime with bass fishing organizations and stuff like that, to, you know, where we have them go out and do plantings. But that was our, Dean, that was our biggest challenge. And the video was breaking up for some reason. I don't know why, but it doesn't do that. But, you know, you're the one that said, you know, we need to get some videos and things like that. And so I'd like to get you a copy of the video and, you know, on that. Yeah, I have a theory, and nobody's going to like it. We had hydrilla. There is no better filter in the world than hydrilla. Okay? And Texas Parks and Wildlife, and I'm sure other state agencies, have said hydrilla is an invasive. What is it, $2,500 fine if it's caught in your boat trailer or live well? We need hydrilla. We can clean that whole lake up and get it crystal clear in a matter of a few years if the hydrilla would take and grow. But the homeowner associations, we cannot fight them. One of the things that Texas Black Bass does and has been very active in is access to the lakes. And homeowners do not want strangers on their lake. Okay, and Texas accommodates them on that by allowing, not the state, but the local governments, building all around the lake, surrounding it, totally cutting it off, no handicap access, nothing, okay? Very few parks, around the lakes, and that's sad. My goal, if you elect me governor, is that I'm going to take a 200-foot strip around the entire lake, and that's going to be the public's land. Okay, but they're not going to elect me on that. I will lose very quickly.
So speaking of nuisance vegetation, this question is kind of for anyone in the audience who has any experience with this, but so in Iowa, now that we're having some success in cleaning up some of our water with our lake restoration program, we're finding out that we're actually really, really good at growing plants. We just need to reduce the turbidity. So some of our managers are now worried that they're going to be facing the issue of native plants, not necessarily non-native, but just sprouting up over the entire reservoir because they have plenty of nutrients to do so, and now they have clear water. Do you have any experience with trying to control access points, reduce vegetation growth using any kind of techniques? And anyone in the audience, I'd like to hear what you have to say.
I think TBBU is the only organization that's ever built a handicap access here in the state, aren't we?
Tom, could you please speak into the microphone so that the folks online can hear you?
Thanks. I believe TBBU is the only organization that's ever built a handicap access pier, and we did that on Lake Nacogdoches.
Maybe a private group building a pier, but the state of Texas.
Hold on, Dave.
They have? Yeah. Well, no, in Dave. The parks. He's absolutely right. In the parks, Texas does a great job with handicap access.
Could we have that comment or get it on the mic for the online comment about what's going on in Texas?
Yes, TBBU has been very active in many fronts, a habitat front here for sure, but they've been a partner of Texas Parks and Wildlife for a long time. They have built fishing piers, handicapped accessible piers, not only just at Lake Nacogdoches, but also have participated in work in other areas too as well. But Texas Parks and Wildlife continues to have ADA piers, you know, in their state parks. There are some river controlling authorities that have built those types of facilities in their own parks too as well. So, you know, but we have ways to go on that front for sure. The question was asked earlier about controls of invasive plants. Right now, hydrilla has not been in Lake Livingston for quite some time. It is a very shallow, windswept lake, high turbidity, mainstream reservoir on the Trinity River. A lot of the sedimentation there that's occurring is coming from the Trinity River, for sure. But we do have water hyacinth and giant sylvania are the two invasive threats there. And there is an active spray program to rid the lake of those, as best we can, of those. But we see what Tom and TBU and their Friends of Reservoirs are doing on Lake Livingston is planting these native plants, offering competition for these exotic, growing space for these exotic plants. So we view it as a form of vegetation control or invasive control as well. So
Texas Parks and Wildlife, And I apologize because I left the state parks out, because every state park that I've ever been to has handicap access to all of their facilities. But the lakes that I'm talking about is where you don't have their local lakes, and Texas Parks and Wildlife does not have a park there. Handicap access is almost restricted. And then, you know, you take a lake like Conroe, they're just totally surrounded by housing. And there's just not a lot you can do there on that. But we have a great system in the Parks and Wildlife, and they are a good partner, and I hope we're a good partner with them. And we work together in trying to address these issues, making fishing, you know, enjoyable sport for everybody, and hopefully they'll be able to catch fish. And we've done a lot of artificial reefs, and And that's a continuing project. That's something I think where they're working on Rayburn real hard is right now is artificial reef in that area. Any other questions?
Other questions for Tom? We're going to have to take offline. Let's get you guys out to a break and get coffeed up and come back here at 11 a.m. We'll see you then.